reason. I just think about my Jesus. I don't need to hype myself up. I just think about your love.
Put my That we can't fathom why God allows things to happen the way that he does. But we know that he said, it is done, it is finished, it is complete. I think the hardest passage of the Bible right now is the one that we need the most. And that's be still and know that I am God. It's hard enough to be still in this season of chaos. It's even harder to tell your soul, be still and know that despite what you see, despite what you feel, despite your disappointments, despite your challenges, we know He is God. Amen. That He reigns over all things. That He holds you in the palm of His hand. He knows the beginning from the end. He is the God of the miracles. So we thank you, Father, that in all this busyness of life right now, we can come for just one moment and remind ourselves just to be still in your presence and to know that you are God over all things, that you reign above everything, that we can trust you.
Oh, yeah.
beautiful. Thank you, Jesus. Free to worship.
praise you that you are on the throne. We're not leaderless, we're not kingless. You are there, you are looking out for us. You're lifting us up. Lord, we praise you this morning. We bless your name. We bless you for your presence. Bless you for your Holy Spirit. Lord, thank you for moving among us. Lord, thank you for working in ways that we haven't yet seen. Thank you for working and comforting and strengthening each one of us, Lord. Thank you for drawing us into your presence and reminding us of how you lift us up and how you carry us. So, Lord, we praise you. You are our God. You are our King. You are on the throne. We exalt you. We praise you. Bless you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Please, would you take your seats? Well, as we come to our tithes and our offerings, so we'll be having a bring and share lunch today. Do please stay behind, even if you haven't brought anything for yourself. Please just stay behind and enjoy the event. We're going to have some, I've already got sight, there's some great food out there, so please do stay behind. Everyone is welcome. Last week we had our Christingle party, and I wonder how your Christingles are looking. We had a great time with these Christingles. The Christingle, of course, the orange with a candle representing Jesus as the light of the world. And then around the outside, there's the fruits, so we're reminded of God's creation. So we had a party and we celebrated by lighting the Christingles, or at least breaking a glow stick over the Christingles, and they were there. I wonder how yours are looking. I wonder if, like me, you left them on the windowsill and the glow candles gradually faded. Eventually, of course, it does become a bit of a shriveled Christingle. But I usually leave it a bit late because I quite like the idea of the sweets that are there. And I think, oh, I'd like the sweets, but I don't want to wreck it. And then I've left it too late. And then the sweets get a bit shriveled and crunchy. And maybe it's been leaned against the spaghetti bolognese and doesn't quite taste. Don't worry, I brought some today. It says bring and share. I've brought some of my sweets today for you. The idea of bringing and sharing is something that we see in the early church. In Acts chapter 4, verses 32 to 33, it goes like this. The whole congregation of believers was united as one. One heart, one mind. They didn't even claim ownership of their possessions. No one said, "That's mine, you can't have it." They shared everything. The apostles gave powerful witness to the resurrection of the Master Jesus, and grace was upon them all. You know, this week I've been taking out the Christians Against Poverty hampers. We decorated the boxes and we filled the boxes a few weeks ago here at Destiny just after the experience. And it's a great privilege to take round the hampers. It's kind of like bringing and sharing, bringing all of the blessings from the churches in Western Supermare and sharing it with our clients. And I wish you could be there. I wish I could kind of video it and capture the moment, because there is such excitement and such thankfulness and gratefulness that I see as we take these amazing hampers to people. It really is a blessing. And let me tell you, there really are people that are struggling at the moment. I visited a woman this week, and during the visit she told me about the debts that she had. And actually, I was there and my heart was just going out hearing about these debts and how she tried to honor God in her giving and was attempting to live a life and deal with these debts, and had called us in, and we'll work with her and we'll make her debt free with God's help. But she showed me at the end how much money she had in her purse, and it was just £10. That was going to last her the whole week. There really are people that are struggling at the moment. And then Liz and I did an emergency food shop on Tuesday evening for another client. And again, she was so grateful. So all the time we are bringing and sharing. Even if you're not there with me on the doorstep, you've helped and contributed. You've brought and we've shared. as we come to our tithes and offerings this morning, let's continue to bring and to share. Bring our gifts to God and then share also in all that we're doing. Share in the costs of this ministry. We're like a family. We share the household expenses, but we do it in order to bless others and that the gospel, the good news of Jesus may go out. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We thank you that you've given us the ability to be blessed and to bring what we have and to share it with others. And Lord, as we do so this morning, we pray that you would bless our giving and use it for your glory. Multiply it, Lord. Use it to reach out to those in need. Bless those who are struggling, we pray. In Jesus' name. Let me just give you the practicalities of how we give here. There are envelopes that are on the chairs. If you are able to gift aid and can do so, it makes a big difference to us. Just write your name and address on the envelope as you give your offering. There'll be someone coming round in a few moments' time. There's Sean at the back who's got a card machine. If you've got a card and wish to give by that, please see Sean before you go. Thank you for watching online. Those of you watching online, thank you so much for joining us. If you wanted to give, there's a QR code that's on the screen now. There's the Destiny Facebook page, and there's the website destinyuk.com. So let's be thankful and joyful as we bring our gifts into God's presence this morning. And let's continue to watch and to wait during this time as we look forward with great excitement as we celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ at Christmas. So let's take up our offering now as we catch up with the latest news of D-Life and all that's going on Destiny Church.
Well, hi everyone and welcome to D-Life. We're so pleased you could join us here today at Destiny Church, and a big welcome to our D-Fam joining us across the world too. Let's see what we've got coming up here at Destiny.
JJ, do you know what it is next week?
I do's. I really, really do's. I'm so excited.
Have you remembered?
Have you been watching D-Life? Excellent. So you all know that it's the kids' nativity next Sunday. You do not want to miss it at 11 o'clock. Don't be late. It's going to be a brilliant time. And guess what?
What?
I am an understudy. How exciting is that? I don't actually know what it means, but it sounds exciting. So, we will see you next Sunday. Don't miss it. Kids Nativity.
Hi, everyone. Trust your preparations are going well. Oh, wait a minute. I've forgotten to order the turkey. I'd better make a note of that. Yes, there's lots of things we need to mark down and jot down and make a list of, but I want you to make a note in your diary for the top event, which is our Christmas Eve experience. It's going to be here at St. George's at 4 o'clock, and then we're going to have carols with mince pies and then drinks, and if you're lucky, you might even get some mulled wine. But remember to make a note in your diary, because this really is the reason for the season. Look forward to seeing you there.
Well, that's it for D-Life for this week. Have a fabulous week. Don't forget, we have the Bring and Share meal straight after the experience today. I can't wait to celebrate with you. The kids' nativity is next Sunday morning. You don't want to miss it. And of course, Christmas Eve experience on the 24th. I'll see you then at 4 o'clock. Have a great week.
Glorious. Wow, so much going on. And I don't want to keep you any longer because I know you can smell what's going on in the kitchen. And so Pastor Mike's going to speed his message up 10 times so that we can get to the food. We were made aware of something this week. Some of you may have heard this on the news or locally, but you know Pastor Mike and I facilitate something called Cliff. I know facilitate's a strange word, but basically it just means we make sure it happens. But we make sure that every month we have a place where all the pastors and leaders from the town or denominations come together. And its aim is really just to support each other. We have some good times together, and it's a great time to just get alongside each other and to really shoulder to shoulder with them. We were able to meet up with Linda Evans. Now, she's the chaplain at the hospital. She's not been able to join us before, but she enlightened us to something that's happening, which we thought that we could get involved in. What is happening is the nurses, and some of the doctors, but it's mainly nurses, they're working such long hours, and because they can't afford to just work on their basic wage, they're taking bank work as well. So very often they're doing their long shift, they're rushing home, they're literally turning around, coming straight back to do their bank work. So they could be working 24 hours. They can't afford to eat. So what's happening is that they've made a little food bank at the hospital. And you'll find that the nurses that can barely afford to eat themselves are bringing in food for other nurses to be able to take from the food bank. And we thought that this is not right. This is not right that this should be happening in our hospital. And we can't solve the problem, but we can help towards it. So we said to her, look, we're a small church, but we've got a big heart. And we can't solve that problem in one fell swoop. But if we can, we can mobilize our people to bring something along so that we can take a box down to help them and put it in their little food bank. So do we think that's a good idea, just to be able to bring, you know what, it's packet soups. It's something that they can quickly turn around because they're not sitting down to a four-course meal. They're literally running home. They need something to eat. They're coming back again to do another shift. None of us know when we're going to need their services. We need them to stay strong and healthy so they can help us. So what we're suggesting is next week, our nativity, don't forget our nativity, our kids are all ready and raring to go. But next week, there'll be a table just at the back. And if you're able just to bring some soups, some packet soups, some pot noodles, maybe it's those pies, what they call, bentos? Do they still do those? Oh, they do. I thought I was showing my age then. You thought, no, is they spab? They certainly do spab. You know, tin meats, stuff that they could turn around quickly, but it just means that they can eat before they go back to work again. So if we can do that, I think that would be such a blessing, just to say, look, we can't solve it, but we can help it over this Christmas period. So thank you for your big hearts. Thank you in advance. And there'll be a table at the back next week, and we'll make sure that it gets to the food bank the week afterwards. Thank you, church.
Change is always possible when we live kindly. True kindness is proved when we're kind to those who believe they're not deserving of it. We won't understand the kindness of others until we accept the kindness of God. We need to base our kindness on one person, and that's God Himself, who sent Jesus in the kindest act that He's ever, ever shown us. The kindest gesture of goodwill. God doesn't want us to live limited by our disability, whatever that might be. That might not be physical, it might be spiritual, it might be something that we struggle with, when we can live in the liberty of His kindness. The King is coming for you because He says you've been dealing with your issues for far too long. And now it's time to come and sit at the King's table. Come on. Come on, it's time. It's time. It's time. Will you accept the invitation? Give a little kindness, give a little kindness, give a little love away. Give a little kindness, give a little kindness, give a little love away. Give a little kindness, give a little kindness, give a little love away. Good morning. Great to be in the house. Great to have you here. Great to welcome Alexei and Ola all the way from the Ukraine. I want to, absolutely, we are so overjoyed to have you with us. I'm going to try to speak one word in Ukrainian. Laskavo prosmo. That means welcome, just in case. Is that right? Great to have you with us. Great to welcome you online. And I hope actually we will be able to broadcast to maybe some friends in the Ukraine in these coming weeks ahead. And wherever you are in the world, just great to have you with us. Pray that you'll be encouraged this morning. If you're not already encouraged, I'm sure you are. But if you just tuned in, pray that this word will be encouraging to you. Just take your phone, and if you are anywhere near Facebook, just press share on the Destiny page, and we can share with the world what we're doing right now. And I really believe this makes a tremendous difference. I'm a bit surprised this morning that there aren't more people in the house when that smell of food is just wafting this way. I mean, you know, if I was in a church where food was being served, I'd make sure I got there. Amen? Come rain, come shine, come ice, come snow. Now, don't even talk to the Ukrainians about snow, because if you complain about just a little bit of ice under your foot, they're going to tell you what it's like to see real ice and snow, right? But just so good to be in the house. Welcome others online now, and let's really get this message out there. Welcome to a part of the world that won't be experiencing snow and ice, our campus in the Philippines. Who knows what weather they're experiencing, but hopefully it's sunny today where they are. And wherever the rest of our DFAM is, great to have you with us. Always good to have you with us every single week. Why don't you just give someone a high five next to you? I was going to say a hug, but not everybody's a hugger. Do you know, we're talking about kindness. We're talking about kindness. Oh, yes. Happy birthday, Eloise. Happy birthday. How old are you? Are you four? Four. Wow. Did you have a fun day yesterday? Partying with your friends. Great. You know, it's always good to be able to share messages, but this series particularly, I've enjoyed sharing because I think it's so relevant right now to the world we live in. So we're going to finish up the series today, Be Kind. By the way, I want to just say a little proviso. Last week, I mispronounced, I'm going to say it wrong now, Mephibosheth, because I trusted Google. And I happened to click on the one translation which said Mephibosheth. So I'm using that all morning. And then Liz very graciously said, oh, I've always heard it pronounced I can't say it now. I've got it in my mind, Mephibosheth. And I went, oh, okay. I went back home and I checked and Liz was right. It was pronounced that way. Anyway, didn't really make any difference, did it? It's fine. So our key thought for the series is kindness is not a built-in quality, but a put-on virtue. I shared a few thoughts last week. Some of these may have appeared in the recap, but I want it to lead into our final part today. And that is true kindness is proved when we're kind to those who believe they're not deserving of it. And I said showing kindness to the unkind is truly kindness in action. So today, I want this to tie into Christmas, the reason for the season, Jesus. But, you know, when we're talking about kindness, what does kindness really look like? Well, kindness is hard to define. But we know when we see it, and we know when we feel it. See, if we did a survey right now, we should have done that. We could have done a survey, and I'd ask you the question, define kindness. we would all find that apart from putting something like it's being nice, we would need to use an illustration to demonstrate what it really is. So we would say, kindness is, not blank, kindness is, for example, I'll fill in the gap, smiling at someone. Oh, don't we need that again? See, we had a bit of that during the pandemic when we were all locked in our houses and we'd venture out and we'd have a walk down the road or in our case around the village, and everybody you bumped into smiled, and most of them would say good morning, good afternoon, hello, hi, whatever, how you doing? Now it's not happening. To get a smile is hard enough, even when you give a smile. So kindness is smiling at someone, speaking to someone, thinking of someone, giving to someone, helping someone, praying for someone. You know, we've been talking, Lois was talking about how we're going to help the nurses and doctors. You know, don't just assume that it's nurses. We could well have doctors, and you go, well, they're paid really well. But you never know when someone's really struggling. It's not about how much money you earn. It's how much money you got to pay out. And so all of a sudden, those doctors might find themselves in very difficult circumstances. And I think it's a sign of the times when we are having to think about others that we wouldn't normally have to consider when it comes to a food bank, and the fact that they've had to set one up. You know, I immediately, when that was shared on Thursday, I said, right, what can we do? Can we bring food? Because I know that some of the nurses will not want to go to the food bank. In fact, what Linda said was they won't even have the time to go to the food bank because they're having to work overtime to earn a little bit more money. And so to go to the food bank is not going to happen, which is why they've set it up there. And it just immediately spoke to me that we need to reach out and help people who maybe we wouldn't normally be thinking of having to help. And we need to show kindness. I want them to know Destiny Church cares. And you think, well, why should we give anything to the hospital when we need it ourselves? Listen, it's what we're going to see today. You spread a little kindness, you'll get a bit of kindness, right? But those things that I said, they're all demonstrations of kindness. But like I shared last week, God's kindness is the measure we need to use for calculating where our kindness needs to be. So in Titus 3, verse 5, it said, when God, our Savior, revealed his kindness and love. So when God sent Jesus into the world, he saved us not because of the righteous things we had done. Salvation was nothing to do with us. It never is. It's always to do with him. It was because of his mercy. He washed away our sins, giving us a new birth and new life through the Holy Spirit. He generously poured out the Spirit upon us through Jesus Christ, our Savior. So I want to sum all that up into one phrase, one thought. Kindness originated with God and was revealed through Jesus. So when we see organizations like I've been sharing the last couple of weeks, you know, all these organizations that are focusing on kindness, they didn't come up with the idea of kindness. It originated with God and was revealed through Jesus. But God didn't just reveal his kindness in giving us Jesus. He demonstrated this kindness through Jesus. And for 33 years, kindness was on display throughout his life and ultimately his death. In fact, let me put that in a thought. Jesus didn't just do kindness, he was kindness. He was kindness. Everything about him was kind. And God wants us just to be like him. Just like him. Because here's what God spoke to me. Kindness is a magnet that draws people in. I wouldn't be a bit surprised if people in the hospital start to hear that Destiny Church has donated food, that they don't find themselves coming this way to find out who we are. Because kindness is a magnet that draws people in. It's appealing, it's alluring, it's captivating, it's enchanting. And because of that, I believe our kindness will draw people to God's love. Just like it did for Rosaria. In her memoir about the journey from being a committed lesbian to a committed Christian, Rosaria Butterfield says that as a non-Christian, her impression of evangelical Christians was that they were poor thinkers, judgmental, scornful, and afraid of diversity. After publishing a critique of an evangelical Christian group in her local newspaper, she received an enormous volume of contrasting responses, placing an empty box in each corner of her desk. She sorted hate mail into one and fan mail into the other. And then she received a 2-page response from a local pastor. It was a kind and inquiring letter, she says. It had a warmth and civility to it, in addition to its probing questions. She couldn't figure out which box to put the letter in, so it sat on her desk for 7 days. It was the kindest letter of opposition that I had ever received, she said. Its tone demonstrated that the writer wasn't against her. Eventually, she contacted the pastor and became friends with him and his wife. They talked with me in a way that didn't make me feel erased. Their friendship was an important part of her journey to faith and freedom. What a lovely story about how powerful kindness is. See, I believe that proves kindness is the greatest evangelistic tool we possess. You know, when people say, I don't know what to say to people, you don't need to say anything. You just need to be kind. Sometimes all you got to do is smile because that's all that that person needs that day. You can give because that's all that that person needs that day. You can inquire how their day is going because that's all they need to be asked that day. If we want to broaden our reach, especially at this time of the year, we need to extend our kindness. Because kindness will speak volumes to people when nothing else will. See, kindness speaks words that far exceed our vocabulary. And it will speak to the most stubborn mind, and it will move the hardest heart. That's what kindness is actually designed to do. Listen to Romans 2 and verse 4, where Paul says, "Do the riches of his extraordinary kindness make you take him for granted and despise him? Haven't you experienced how kind and understanding he has been to you? Don't mistake his tolerance for acceptance. Do you realize that all the wealth of his extravagant kindness is meant to melt your heart? It's meant to melt your heart and lead you into repentance. Wow. Kindness is meant to melt the hardest heart. Anybody ever seen that in action? I have. I've seen some of the most unkind be shown kindness, and there has been immediate change. Because how can you push away someone who's being kind? I'm not saying that it never has happened, but it's very hard to do when someone is extending kindness to you. You know, even the people that sometimes when I see when I'm walking down the road that maybe just want to walk by on the other side, but I kind of say good morning or good afternoon, and suddenly they're prompted and they're like, oh, good morning. It might not even be said very friendly, but it prompts a response. Why? Because they feel obliged to have to respond in some way. They can't just walk by. I'm not saying that we've ever, you know, never had anybody walk by and not respond, but it's very rare that even those that want to keep themselves to themselves, we have a kid that goes by with headphones on, he's walking his dog. His dog is really loud, but he never hears it because he's got his headphones on. Who knows what he's listening to? But I can sometimes say something and there's no response, so I have to go. Sometimes I just think, oh, what's the point? He's not going to hear me. But that isn't the point, is it? The very fact that I should just wave then, because he can't ignore a wave. Let's never take God's kindness for granted. Let's always allow it to melt our hearts more and more. You know, it's so easy to just think that this might be about someone we're thinking about right now. Because we all know people with hard hearts, right? And you might have names in your mind right now, and you're thinking, cool, they so need to hear this message. Let me get on Facebook and just personally post it to their profile. How about the fact that our hearts are not yet where they should be? How about the fact that our hearts are still hardened? How about the fact that we can still respond in unkind ways? We don't have to try hard, it's easy. It's actually hard to practice kindness. And let God's spirit of kindness melt our hearts. See, we were drawn by his kindness before we first accepted his love and his grace. It was his kindness that attracted us and led us to salvation. How could this God that loves us so much be so kind? It still blows my mind that he is as kind as he is. How many of you have experienced God's kindness? I just want to make sure that everybody has. You see, it's an ongoing journey. It's not something that we just have as a one-off. Even though the one-off was that Jesus went to the cross, but the work of the cross continues throughout our lifetime and beyond. And you know the repentance that it's talking about is an ongoing journey, because we need to extend that kindness to others. You don't need me to remind you that our culture is full of unkindness and even hatred. We've only got to accidentally bump into someone in the high street. Or maybe you're walking around the supermarket and your trolley bumps into someone else. And invariably we start to see unkindness play out. Not so bad nowadays, but remember when they first did Black Friday? And they were selling televisions, anybody remember that? And people would clamber over each other and they'd push each other, and then it'd break into full-fledged fights to get the bargain. And then they'd, you know, someone would be tugging one side and tugging with the other side with TVs. Wow. A demonstration of how people can find it so easy to... I bet not many people at that time said, oh, you take the television. You take the television. It's fine. I don't need it. Wouldn't that have been great if people did do that? That would have been wonderful. Wonderful. We've only got to log on to social media. Twitter, Facebook. And we see a deluge of unkindness and even hatred, sometimes shockingly, between brothers and sisters in Christ who disagree with each other. I remember around Brexit. Oh, my. I watched people who I know just saying unkind things to one another about Brexit. It's like, guys, we're supposed to be demonstrating kindness. And actually, some people did speak up and say, come on, come on. Don't lose perspective of what the enemy is trying to do right now with unkindness. I don't know that unfriend or block are necessarily good terms to really promote kindness. And normally when you want to unfriend or you want to block, I know that there are times, I know that we have to have those things, I know that we have to use those things, I know sometimes stuff appears on our feed and we're like, okay, we need to get this off now and we need to block. But I see people doing that when they don't like the opinion of someone else and they're just going, block! Almost like in such an unkind way. There are a few very well-known personalities who I'm thinking of right now who promote unkindness by saying, I mean, no, I can't say their names. But if I said one of them uses a phrase, you're fired, you know who I'm talking about. And I see the unkindness, you know, and that person in my estimation has gone down in my estimation because of the way that he treats the unkindness of others rather than just letting it go. We are not going to build a healthy society when we just fire unkindness at the unkind. And we as believers need to set the example. Well, let me give you another example. How about the news channels? Full of unkindness. Reporting about unkindness in the world. Reporting about hatred in the world. Reporting about something where someone has been unkind to someone else. And it's clear to me the world, like never before, needs a massive dose of kindness. In fact, we carry the responsibility. I'm going to put it in a thought. We are the prescribers for doses of kindness. And you know what? In the same way that they're saying there's a shortage of amoxicillin, there is a shortage of doses of kindness. But it's not because we don't have stock. Did you like the link? It's not because we've run down supplies. It's because we're not prescribing it. Amen? We got to prescribe kindness. Every day, we got to be examples of kindness. Let's go back to our key scripture, Titus, and chapter 3 and verse 3. It says, once we too were foolish and disobedient. We forget where we've come from. We weren't all that in a bag of chips. Some people think they saved themselves. They walk around full of themselves. I think what that shows you is that throughout life, You start off accepting the love of God because you need God so much. But over the years, you become full of yourself. And then you believe you got this. I tell you what, I never believe I've got this. If God didn't have me, who knows where I would be? We all need his kindness. So it says, once we too were foolish and disobedient. What's that trying to say to you? It's trying to say, listen, when you look at other people and you think they're foolish and disobedient, just remember where you come from. We were misled and became slaves to many lusts and pleasures. Our lives were full of envy, evil and envy, and we hated each other. In other words, if we were to sum that up, we were a mess. But God turned our mess into a message. We didn't realize it, but we were so far away from God and all he offered. And we didn't deserve his wonderful gift of salvation through Jesus, but despite that, he still gave. Look what it says in verse 4. But when God, our Savior, revealed his kindness and love, he saved us. He saved us. We've done nothing to save ourselves. We can do nothing to save ourselves. That's what goes on in the world. And that's the danger of the other side of kindness, that people think that if they do enough good works, it will be enough to get them into heaven. That actually they can escape having to give God all the credit and having to give God their lives, because goodness and kindness will get me there. I want to tell you, goodness and kindness on its own will not get you there. You need a relationship with Jesus Christ, your Savior. Amen. No amount of kindness is going to get you there. You could work for every charity in the world doing charitable acts, but let me tell you, it won't get you to heaven. You can only get there through Jesus, who was kind and loving and full of grace. So today, can I just say this? Because we've had kindness extended to us, we need to extend it to others. Let me ask you, here's a million-dollar question. Ready? I feel like I need Who Wants to Be a Millionaire music behind me right now. Here's a million-dollar question. Are you kind? Everybody's so humble, they're like, I don't say a word. Can you recognize where you are kind and when you are unkind? Because I think that's the key. If we can recognize where we're kind, and more importantly, when we're unkind, we can turn that unkindness around to become kinder. Let's treat others with the same kindness we've been shown. Right now, today, be kind and don't talk about the football. Be kind to those who are mourning today. Be kind to those who are downhearted today. I noticed Jeff's not here. I guess he's working, but it could be because of the football. No, I'm only kidding. But if he was here, be kind. Let's not talk about it. Let's not talk about it. We'll all get going. I was kind of watching it in the background last night. I couldn't watch. Lois was giving me a running commentary. And I'm like, ah! And she's got her head in her hands. We're not even into football. And it affected us. Let's just give Jesus the last word, shall we? He said in Luke 6, verse 31, here is a simple rule of thumb for behavior. Ask yourself what you want people to do for you, then grab the initiative and do it for them. So rather than say, why should we give nurses food? Say, of course we should give nurses food. Because when we sow, we will... If you only love the lovable, do you expect a pat on the back? Run-of-the-mill sinners do that. If you only help those who help you, do you expect a medal? Garden variety sinners do that. If you only give for what you hope to get out of it, do you think that's charity? We're not giving to the nurses to get anything back. We don't want anything back. Apart from, I pray they come to know Jesus. Says the stingiest of pawnbrokers does that. I tell you, love your enemies. Help and give without expecting a return. You'll never, I promise, regret it. Live out this God-created identity the way our Father lives towards us, generously and graciously, even when we're at our worst. And here is the line. We could have just read this one line. Listen to this. Our Father is kind. You be kind. There it is. It's not because other people need to be kind. Our Father is kind, so we need to be kind. Let me tell you, standing up here and preaching this is no easier than being where you are listening to it. Because I am fully aware of my unkindness. I am fully aware of how easy it is. When we're driving the car, that's where a lot of unkindness happens. Okay, pastor's confession time. Should have had a box up here, shouldn't I? It's easy. But I've started to try and turn that around. When someone jumps the queue, ooh, that irritates me. Ooh, someone jumps the queue. When you've been waiting a long time, I almost got arrested in Dubai about 5 years ago. Because someone jumped the queue and he thought it was funny. And he was with his friends and he was laughing about it. And I said, I saw you. And he said, like this. He was trying to get out of it now. So he was trying to get me to be partakers of this jump in the queue. And I said, no way. So when I got... Then he was just laughing about it. So I got to the front and I said to the attendant, we were in a water park and we were up high. We were about to go down in like a rubber ring thing. And I told the attendant and he said, what would you like me to do, sir? Shall I call the police? Now, thankfully, I had enough wisdom to say, no, it's fine. Actually, I found out afterwards in Dubai, the police listen to the first person. So if they got there first, I may have ended up in jail. Anyway, they held these people back. We went down the slide, but just as before we went, they said, we'll get them at the bottom. I want to tell you, I have never ran out of the water so fast in my life. Unkindness. It happens. What was the kindest thing we could have done that day? Well, I guess we could have let them go first. That wasn't kind of in our hands by that point, because I think they wanted to hold them back and to talk to them. But maybe the kindness was that we didn't report it to the police. Being unkind to those who don't deserve it. Our Father is kind, you be kind. That's like drop the mic. So today, let's stand together. Are you drawn to the kindness of God through Jesus? I wonder, I'm asking that question both in the house and also online. Are you drawn by the kindness of Jesus? If you are, can I lead you in a prayer to experience his kindness, to have your life turned around by his kindness. If that's you right now, if you want to give your life to Jesus, just pray these words and say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart today. Thank you for being so kind. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. There is nothing I can do to save myself, but you did everything you needed to save me through the kindness that you extended through Jesus. And all I can do today is accept that kindness. Thank you that even though I may have made a mess of my life, I may have done things that have not pleased you, I can come to you today and I can thank you ahead of time that you will turn my mess into a message. So I give my heart to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Can I ask, while we keep our eyes closed, did anybody pray that in the house today? Just raise your hand. Thank you, Jesus. Anybody else pray that in the house? Did you pray that online today? Just let us know in the comments below or send an email to prayer@destinyuk.com. Maybe you've already given your life to Jesus, so you know his kindness. But if you're honest, your kindness is not where it could be, and maybe not even where it should be, but you know you're a work in progress. And right now, wherever you are, God is calling you to be a prescriber of doses of kindness. You could have been a believer for a day, and God is saying, you have enough kindness to be going on with to be able to share this kindness with other people. Are you willing, especially at this time of the year, to prescribe that kindness in massive doses to other people around you? Can I pray for you if that's you today? If you're saying on the inside, you know what? Yes, I want to prescribe kindness. I'll include you in this prayer. Father, thank you. Thank you that you prescribed the biggest dose of kindness ever that the world has ever seen through Jesus. Lord, we don't want to take it for granted. We don't even want to believe that because we've been accepted that everything that we do is acceptable. We read in that scripture that actually you tolerate some things. And Father, we want to hand over to you today our unkindness, our sin, our bad thoughts, our bad words, our bad deeds, and we just hand it all over to you and say thank you for your kindness, that in Jesus all of this is sorted out, all of this is covered by your love and your grace. Thank you that we are a work in progress. Thank you that we can repent today. And maybe that's something today that you want to do right here, right now, and say, Father, I repent of my unkindness and the things I've done, and especially the things I've done that I didn't even recognize that I'd done, the unkindness that I extended to others that I didn't even realize I'd extended. And today, I repent because I am a work in progress. Would you help me, Lord, to extend kindness, not just to the kind, not just to the lovely, not just to those who show it to me, but to this watching world. Wherever I go this week, help me to be kind. Whatever I do this week, help me to be kind. Whoever I might accidentally bump into this week, help me to be kind. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. We're uncovering more and more of God's kindness every day.
Good.